Good morning, friends. Welcome back to our playlist on the corporate valuation. Last time we have discussed that we'll be having 9 lectures on the corporate valuation, and we will cover the practical aspect of it and all the methods which are used normally in the industry. We will go through it. We'll run through it. Basically, we will discuss today some primary methods of valuation which people were using in past. Now it is a history. Today we will also discuss the primary aspect of the discounting cash flow method and the application of it. And then from next lecture, we will start with the practicals. So basically, we have discussed last time that we will run through the approaches of the valuation, then valuation tool, then purpose of valuation, then discounted value of method, the valuation method, then choosing the right valuation method, the relative concept of the valuation. Then we have seen that we will do the valuation of brand, private equities, acquisition, and value-based management, EVA and MBA. And then we'll go through some case studies. So let us start with, say, valuation proper. Normally, whenever we do a valuation, the time value plays a very important role. So suppose there is a company who wants to sell their business, then the company will have to come out with what is the growth factor, what will be the growth in next 3 years to 5 years, and what will be the terminal year growth, and what will be the growth after the terminal value. So terminal year. So that is what the time value comes into picture. We will have a discounting factor. So present value, present to future, we need to understand the value, how to arrive at it. Then we'll have a future to present. Then we will have the cash flow and their timing. So as I said, 3 to 5 years, the horizon, we will have to keep it. And then we need to understand how the value will come into picture. Then what rates to use for compounding or the discounting. So compounding we'll use when we have to come from present to future, and discounting we will be using the WACC method or WACC method or any kind of equity rate of valuation method or debt valuation method. So there we will use this kind of stuff. So say for example, the company has a cost of capital as around 15%, including both equity and debt. Then we will discount at the rate of 15%. So now, how to arrive the value? So present value to future cash flow. So we have to go to the present value to future cash flows. That will be happening with the discounting factor. Then we have to work out the future cash flows. That is the step number two. We have to understand the rate of discounting. So we have to find out the rate of discounting. Step number three. We'll have to go through the risk factor. Sometimes there is an industry risk, sometimes there is a country risk, and sometimes there is a company risk. So in this terminology, we call it as a beta. So we have to find out the industry beta and the company beta. Normally both are same, both are calculated simultaneously. It is not same, but we need to calculate simultaneously. Then there's a risk premium. So if certain industries, say for example, industry in steel, so it is a risky because the price of steel is going upwards and downwards frequently. Then there is a risk-free return. So if you are investing into a bond or a government bond or FDs, then what is the risk return? There is no risk in that. So we will have around 4%, 5%. As of now, with this lockdown, we have a 5% risk return. Then expectation from the business or industry. So that is we have to keep in mind that what is the expectation of the industry. If it is very high, then you have to fulfill those expectations. So your valuation will go down. And if it is moderate, then your valuation will be fine. If it is very less, then you can demand your monopoly's value of the company or the industry. To work out the step number two, work out the future cash flow, we will have to work out the revenue of estimation and the expense estimation. And then estimation of the capex and the working capital. What will happen is that when you work out the revenue and expenses, we will come out to the EBITDA or the PBT. Now after EBITDA and PBT, we will add back the depreciation and all. So we need to understand the out of this PBT, after this PBT, what is my cash flow? I need to reduce the what is the investment in capex required to achieve this particular revenue, and what will be my working capital investment to achieve this particular growth. That is where we need to understand that estimation of capex and working capital we need to reduce from the particularly from the EBITDA and PBT. This is what the steps are. So we need to understand the step by step we will we'll have approach towards the corporate valuation. Then to understand this particular steps or the projections, there are value drivers. So these value drivers are what is the business prospect. This is the theory particularly. Growth of industry, management philosophy, succession planning. Sometimes the value, the business is good, but there is no succession, then the value is not good. Then sources of suppliers, manpower, attrition rate, etc. So suppliers, like for example, if you have only one supplier, then you are at a higher risk. You have only one customer, then you are also at a higher risk. So valuation will go down. Competitor mapping, threats, what are the threats in the industry? Say for example, in lockdown, there are the threats to the cloth market, yarn market. It is not working at all. So against this, there is a pharmaceutical market. So there is a growth available. So threats, we need to understand the, what are the threats to this particular business and what are the opportunities to this particular business. Then we have a terminal period and terminal growth. The terminal period is the period where we normally expect the five years particular business will run at a good rate. And after that, the industry expect that maybe the growth rate may change, but we are not sure what will happen. So we'll say that infinity, the growth rate will be around 3% or 4%. So terminal growth is normally 4 to 5% based on depending on the industry to industry. Then factors affecting the prospects. So again, for the steps which we have discussed in the last two slides, these are the theories which we have to apply. So industry growth, industry threats, industry technology, then we have to go for company market share, then PLC, product life cycle, then brand, acceptance and management. So about the management, about the acceptance of the product, about the acceptance of the brand, then product life cycle. If you're on a growth stage, you make it a good price. If you're on a decline stage, people may not give you a good price. If you're on an infancy stage, again, you need to wait for some time and then sell off a business. So such kind of things will come into picture. Then before we value ourselves, because there is a buyer and there is a seller. So if we are a seller, then we need to understand that buyer is not a fool to give you a good price. He will always see from all the angles. So basically, what are the four angles where the buyer will have an eye on? Liability, income and expenses. The seller will always say that I have a good asset and I have a lesser liability. The buyer will prove that you have a lesser value of asset and the higher value of liability. The seller will always say that I have a growth pattern of income in future. But the buyer will say no, you have a limited pattern of income in future and you have a high expenditure to earn that particular income. That is why we need to understand that whenever we frame a valuation, we need to eliminate those discarded assets and we need to determine the liability which is not certain. Put it into valuation. Side by side, we need to also keep such expenditure in the asset, say for example R&D. Design and capitalize it in the asset so that we can inform the buyer that, see boss, this is what my asset, I have a design, I have a pattern, I have a research equipments which will be used for the future growth of the business. Obviously you must have taken into those consideration for income analysis, but if you are not bringing into the books, it will not be available. Second thing, debtors more than 180 days or assets more than 180 days, slow moving inventory, slow moving debtors, long outstanding of suppliers, income tax payments, custom excise payments. Those are to be removed from the books. If the cases are over and if the debtors are not good, then write it off. And in the current year itself, you need to see that your EBITDA is to the level of expectation. And then you plan an income analysis so that you will not bring those particular debtors or the asset into the books. Although I'm going to very deep for the theory, because this is the basic analysis which a buyer and a seller will do when there is a due diligence. So whatever I have explained, that is written here. So asset shown, but not really the asset, and life of the asset is over, which need to be removed. Physically available, but not in asset like fixture and master, etc. We need to bring in the books, or we need to bring in the value separately in a sheet, or which is called as a task sheet. Then impairment provision, some of the assets are there physically, but those are 20 years, 30 years long. Remove that. So we need to provide for the impairment. Because if you will not provide for the impairment, then the seller will buyer will always ask for it. Then revaluation of the assets, if it is really to be revalued. Intangible asset to bring to the books. Intangible assets capitalized, but no value in the market. Then you need to remove. Say, for example, if you have a certain asset which does not have so there are certain R&D expenses or the goodwill, we need to take it in the books. Then title clearance of the building, if it is not clear, then we need to clear, otherwise they will not take the building value into consideration. Then brand value, investment in HR, that is also we need to take into consideration. Then we have a contingent liability in a liability side. This all we have discussed now. Then the liability related to direct and indirect taxes, which we have said. Then we really are liability but kept outside a book. So sometimes we say that it is not a liability, but it is a contingent liability. It may happen. Then we have a loss of provisions, the loss provision not done. So sometimes we don't expect a loss in particular thing, but there is a loss. So they will expect that provision to be made. Product warranty liability. Sometimes in an industry, we give the warranty. So as of now, how much warranty is given in the market to the customer? Because the person who will buy a business, they will also will buy a warranty liability. So those liability will have to reduce from the, particularly from the, from your asset valuation. Gratuity liability, litigation liability, and environment liability. Then guarantee or warranty liability, which is the same the way we have a product warranty liability. So these are the liability side that we need to understand. Protections, we have already discussed that we need to arrive at the EBITDA, PBT, and PAT. Sometimes we need to give a stress to particular income and give a escalation to particular expense. Both the side, income ko 10% se bada do, or income ko 10% se kam kar do, or expense ko 10% se bada do. So both the side it will be stressed, and your EBITDA will be a stressed EBITDA. So we are coming to a valuation method. We have a PECV method, we have a dividend, then we have a PECV method is a historic method. Then I have divided into four parts: asset, earning, multiple, and DCF. So if you look at the asset, then we have a liquidation and replacement methods. If you have a earning, then based on the earning, then we have PECV and dividend method. If it is a DCF, then we have a free cash flow of firm and free cash flow of equity method. There are again one stage, two stage, three stage methods. If there is a multiple, then we have a PE multiple, PEG multiple, EBITDA multiple, sales multiple. The various kind of multiples are there, like it is called as a relative valuation method. Coming to a net asset value method, the first method where it is mostly now not used frequently, but it is kept as a theory and people are just re-verifying with this particular method. So it takes into consideration one, fixed assets current assets on one side, current liability and loans on the other side. Net residual is the value of the business, and it is based on the last audited unaudited balance sheet. It does not cover the future prospects. So this is to be noted down that it doesn't cover the future prospects. It is whatever is the books, then they will do that. This is a small example. We'll just run through it quickly. Net asset method. Suppose the company has a 1,000 rupees of net asset, then there is a asset net current asset is 885, then investment is 500, deferred tax liability is 100 minus loan available in the books of account is 930, then net asset value is of the company is 1355. Now sometimes we have adjustment we do that, okay, whatever investment I have, this is a book value of 500, but there is an appreciation in the market of 350, I have added. Preference share capital will not come into picture because we are doing a valuation of the equity point of view. So we will reduce 150. Then we have a contingent liability of 20. So net adjusted asset will be 1535. So what we have done, jitna bhi book mein tha, wo le liya, minus humne jo book ke bahar tha, wo humne minus kiya. And then we have done whatever is, after that, we have divided the 1535 with the number of shares. So we got the value per share. So my value is 171 rupee per share. So second method is price earning capitalization method, where we have a maintainable profits, then appropriate rate, tax rate will apply, and we will have a multi. So another example of this method is, you will see here, the 13, 14, 14, 15, and 15, 16, we have taken the profitability. Now, here, reported profit for these 3 years we have taken. Then, we have taken the total other income. That's some other income like dividend income or the profit on sale of assets or investments, some kind of stuff. So, we have 410, 458, 500. We have total non-recurring expenses of 14 lakhs, 25 lakhs, and these are all to be taken care of while we will do so. Whatever the non-recurring expenses we need to attack. So you have profit 144, 347, and 432 respectively for the year, and then you have a add back to interest and depreciation to arrive at the EBITDA. So here we will take the EBITDA into picture. This value is also not frequently used by the industry. So we have 13, 14, 14, 15, 15, 16. We'll give a weight. This is the profit. If you look at here, this is the profit, net PBT. This one. So we'll do this, then we will give today the value is 0. So tomorrow it will be maybe 1. Day after tomorrow it will be 2 or 3. Whatever you have value, you can choose based on the industry expectation and the growth rate. So we have 779. We got the product of these multiples. Then we have a profit. Maintainable PBT is 390 because it's an average we have taken. And tax rate is 34.61%, say for example. So we have a PAT is 255. Then PE multiple taken for the example is 15. So we have a capitalized value of business is 3821. Then we have adjustments 850 for investments, because we have to add the investment, but these are appearing in the books of, then contingent liability, then deferred tax liability, then preference share capital, always we will reduce. So 4401, and then we will divide by the amount of 9 lakhs share. So we have a value of 489. So issues in PEC method, the valuation of loss making company, we have a problem. If we follow the PEC method, then startup company we cannot value with this, because startup company may profit nahi hota ya fir year hi nahi hota. It's a startup company, so it's just beginning of the business. Then finite life project companies is difficult. Ignores time value of money, which is a core part of this particular chapter. Calculation of maintainable profit, adjustment for non-operating income and non-recurring items to derive from the books of account is very difficult. Finding listed company comparables is difficult. If it is there also, then if you get it also, then you will not be able to apply to the particular method. the difficulty in obtaining the comparable multiple, because people are not using this particular method, so you not get the comparables in this. And effective tax rate is playing a major role, so that is also part of the issue in the PC. Friends, I think we will stop here. We will go through the discounted cash flow method in our next lecture, because it is a topic in itself, and so we will take up a discounted cash flow method in the next lecture. Maybe the next week we will take it discounted valuation method. Then we will be having a single stage and double stage and third and three stage method of valuation. And after that, we will also see that how we apply discounted valuation method in practice. So till then, friends, stay tuned to my YouTube videos, and you need to apply this time as a playlist of corporate valuation. We always say that grow yourself. Sky is the beginning, and there is no limit. So till then, thank you very much, friends, and stay tuned to my next videos. And we will be coming up with the strategic cost management also in few days. Thank you very much.